You're looking at Psalm 49. The first 15 verses, Psalm 49. It's a psalm to the choir master, a psalm of the sons of Korah. Hear this, all peoples. Give ear, all inhabitants of the world, both low and high, rich and poor together. My mouth shall speak wisdom. The meditation of my heart shall be understanding. I will incline my ear to a proverb. I will solve my riddle to the music of the lyre. Why should I fear in times of trouble when the iniquity of those who cheat me surrounds me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast of their abundance of their riches. Truly, no man can ransom another or give to God the price of his life, for the ransom of their life is costly and can never suffice, that he should live on forever and never see the pit. For he sees that even the wise die. The fool and the stupid alike must perish and leave their wealth to others. Their graves are their homes forever, their dwelling places to all generations. Though they called lands by their own names, man in his pomp will not remain. He is like the beasts that perish. This is the path of those who have foolish confidence. Yet after them people approve of their boasts. Like sheep, they are appointed for Sheol. Death shall be their shepherd, and the upright shall rule over them in the morning. Their form shall be consumed in Sheol with no place to dwell. But God will ransom my soul from the power of Sheol, for he will receive me. Let's pray. Father God, we have heard of the good work being done through shoeboxes and Operation Christmas Child, and we ask that you would continue to bless this work. And Lord, bring many to Christ through it. Lord, as we think about where some of those shoeboxes are going, we're reminded that these are troubling times. We see sin around us. And God, we too often see sin within us. We see the wicked prosper. Those we admire and love, they face sickness and disease. Lord, help us. Remind us. Remind us, Lord, remind us that this is not the end. Remind us that you are a just God and will be a just judge. Remind us that the wicked are appointed for eternal suffering, but the upright for eternal rest and rule with you. And this morning, Lord, as you remind us, we will sing your praises. This morning, we will bring our offerings for you to bless and use for your glory. This morning, we will offer you our prayers because, Lord, we are utterly dependent upon you. And this morning we will give you thanks because everything good we have comes from you. And Lord, we will trust you. God, we will hear your word this morning and we will trust that your word is true. We will believe it. And God, we will do with it as you will by your grace. Lord, I pray that this morning your people would be drawn close to you. I pray that this morning your name would be glorified above every other name. We pray especially that the name of Jesus would be exalted, and it is in that name we pray. Amen. Please remain standing as we sing.
Sing his greatness, all creation. Praise. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. Dear Lord, we thank you that our sins are many, but yet you went to that cross to shed that blood, dear Lord. And you redeemed us. Our sins are washed away. Dear Lord, I thank you for that blessing you have given us, that salvation you have given us, dear Lord, if we receive it. I pray that you'll be with the pastor as he brings the message. I thank you for what we've heard so far from the missionaries that have been here. And dear Lord, what's going on? It's encouraging. I pray that you'll give them the strength, guide them, and keep them safe each and every day they serve you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Go ahead and open your Bible to Exodus chapter 20. While we don't want to put too much stock in statistics, some of the numbers today are not pretty. According to the CDC, and I was almost reluctant to say that, there were about 5 marriages for every 1,000 people in the United States in 2020. That number was 8.2 20 years ago. Americans are not walking the aisle. There were about 2.3 divorces for every 1,000 people in 2020, about half the divorce rate from 20 years ago. So while we might rejoice, saying, hey, there are fewer divorces, we have to recognize the reason is people are not bothering to get married in the first place. And I doubt any of us believe that it's because fewer people are living together. In any case, it is clear, Americans do not value the covenant of marriage. They don't get married, and when they do, they don't stay that way. That is not the way God designed things. That is not his desire for mankind. As we dig into the 7th commandment this morning, we will see what God's view is regarding marriage. And it's really simple. God wants his people to protect marriage. Let's remind ourselves of what we've already seen in the 10 commandments. First of all, remember where they came. The 10 commandments came as the old covenant people of Israel were about to enter the land. They were about to get the blessing of living as God's people in the presence of the Almighty God. And God wanted them to have joy as they lived there. And that was only going to come if they lived according to the instructions he gave them. So these are God's instructions for his people that they might have joy living in his presence. And we've already looked at the first 6 commandments. There's only one God, and you're not to forget that. You're not to worship him through images. You're not, when you take his name, you're not to take it in vain. And that's not just speaking, you wear his name. And we're to protect his day, and we're to protect the family, and we're to protect life. And now we find we are to protect marriage. The 7th commandment continues that theme of protection. We are to protect marriage. I'm going to ask that you stand once more in honor of God's word. And again, you will not stand very long. The verse is short, but it's still God's word. Exodus chapter 20, verse 14. You shall not commit adultery. Father, this is your word. It is simple, yet profound. It is true. And God, as we hear it this morning, we simply ask this. Make its message clear to us. Give us hearts to believe it. And Lord, change our wills that we might glorify you as we obey it. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. 7th commandment, written on stone at Sinai and on the hearts of God's new covenant people, the church, demands that God's people protect marriage. Now we want to follow the path we've been following as we've looked at each one of these commandments. We're going to see what it meant for Israel. We're going to see what Jesus had to do with the commandment. And then we're going to say, well, what does that mean for us? What does it mean for the new covenant people, the church? Starting with Israel, the command is really simple. It was tied to God's covenant with his people. The command is protect marriage because this matters for your covenant. The command is simple. You shall not commit adultery, but the reasoning for the commandment runs deep. It runs deep. This is a command to protect marriage, and the Bible is clear about the sinfulness of all sexual sin, right? But this is specifically a command against adultery. Adultery is breaking the covenant bond between a husband and wife. This command says you shall not do that. Now, the rest of the passages in the law of Moses make it very clear that sexual sin of any kind is wrong. But this is a command against adultery. And the rest of the commandment and law makes that clear, too. It's simple. Married men may not engage with physical relationships with anyone but their wife. Married women may not engage in physical relationships with anybody but their husband. And nobody may engage in physical relationships with a married person to whom they are not married. That's adultery. And in Israel, this would also include another group. It would include those who are engaged to be married. Because in Israel, engagement was where the legal relationship was entered into. Engagement was a legal bond that took a divorce to break. So it was adultery to break that bond once they were engaged. The rest of the ancient Near East, at the time of Israel, everywhere in the ancient Near East, adultery was called the great sin. Pagans, we have pagan documents from thousands of years ago that call adultery the great sin. And it's called that in Israel too. In Genesis 20, Abimelech, when Abraham tries that passing his wife off as his sister thing, Abimelech, the king of Gerar, calls it the great sin. We may live in a society that thinks marriage, divorce, and adultery are no big deal. But that actually makes us an anomaly in the history of the world. We're weird. Before the modern era, people understood that marriage was more significant than any other human bond. It was sealed with a solemn oath. In a culture that took oaths seriously, it was consummated in the most intimate act that can occur between two people, and it was the foundation for building families and fulfilling the creation mandate. So to take that intimate relationship of marriage that God designed to exist between a husband and wife and bring another person into that mix was a great sin against the spouse, but it was also a gross sin against God and His design for humanity. And everybody got that. You know, Genesis 2:24 describes the intimacy between a husband and wife as saying the two are one flesh. One flesh. So the spiritual implications of the sin of adultery are staggering. Think about this. When adultery happens, you have the most important human relationship of all. One of those in that relationship has proven unfaithful. They have proven that they are not faithful in covenant keeping. In one of the most important human relationships, one of them involved has proven selfish and unloving. That in a covenant, they seek their own good instead of the good of that relationship. When adultery occurs in one of the most important human relationships of all, one of those in that relationship has revealed they have a heart of rebellion. That when they are in a covenant relationship, they would prefer to act out in rebellion. And when in the most important of human relationships, one of them has proven dishonest, they made an oath. And so in their covenant keeping, they are proving themselves dishonest. And if they are that way in the physical, obvious covenant they have with their spouse, how do you think they will be in their covenant relationship to the Almighty God? The spiritual implications of adultery are huge. Is there any reason to think someone who is so willing to break the covenant relationship found in marriage, why would we think they would be faithful in their covenant relationship with their God? There's a reason that Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel all describe Israel's idolatry as adultery. It's because They are covenant breakers. That's why Hosea, his whole book is built around, Hosea, go call for yourself a wife of adultery. And it's remarkable as Hosea is a picture of the way God pursues adulterous people. And he's not saying that they're all breaking the relationship with their spouse. He's using adultery as a picture of idolatry because they are both pictures of covenant breaking. So in Israel, the command to protect marriage was tied intimately with God's covenant relationship to his people. What did Jesus do with that when he came, though? Because we know Jesus takes like all these big laws and he does something with them. When he comes, either his coming affects them, especially those first commandments, or he says something about them that makes us rethink them. And that's what happens with this one. Jesus refines the commandment, and Jesus deals with it. Now, the teachings of Jesus on adultery are controversial, to say the least. They are controversial, I think, in the most part, because we live in a culture that has so degraded marriage that almost everyone in the room this morning either is someone or loves someone that Jesus would label an adulterer. It's personal. We don't come to what Jesus says here this morning as something that we can think about as those people do that. This hits home to all of us. And so as we look at these, we want to look at him carefully, and we want to be careful that we don't let our sin or our love for sinners change the way we hear what Jesus has to say. So just let Jesus speak is what we're going to try to do. And if as we come to this, you think, well, I'm not sure what Pastor said there. First of all, come talk with me and we'll work through that. Now, if you think I don't like what Jesus had to say, talk with him, then come talk with me and we'll work through that too. Okay? Look at what he says. Matthew 5, verse 27. So Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. Jesus says, "You have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has already committed adultery with her in his heart. For if your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it is better that you lose one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. For it is better you lose one of your members than that your whole body go into hell." See what Jesus did? We've seen it before, right? Jesus equates the sin of the eyes and the heart with the sin of the flesh, just like he did the sixth commandment. Jesus says that if your heart lusts after someone that is not your spouse, you have committed adultery with them. And then Jesus does something else, right? In the Old Testament, if we looked, the penalty for adultery was death. The penalty to adultery, they took you out and they stoned both of you to death. And Jesus says, well, here though, if you look at someone and you lust in your heart, that's adultery. But instead of death, he says that the penalty is hell. It's better that you'd lose your eyes than you'd spend eternity in hell. So he says heart adultery deserves hell. Now, Jesus is not calling for you to go mutilate your physical body. He's calling for you to not lust after people that you're not married to, okay? But he's making his point. He says, and then what he does in verses 31 to 32, Jesus says the divorce is also adultery. Verse 31, it was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now Jesus is referring back to Deuteronomy 24, verse 1. And that passage says that if a man in Israel gives his wife a certificate of divorce because he finds some reason he wants to divorce her, And she goes and marries another man, and he finds a reason he wants to divorce her, and he gives her a certificate of divorce. The first man can't marry her again because she's an adulteress, is the point. That would be evil in Israel. All right? That's all it says. It says, if this happens, this can't happen. First century Jewish leaders turned that into, whoever wants to divorce his wife needs to do the paperwork. Needs to give her a certificate of divorce. And they created a big debate about it. You got this group over here that says, only for sexual immorality. That's the only reason there can be divorce. And this group over here says, oh, no, no. If she does anything that he doesn't like, he can divorce her. Bad dinner. Boom. Certificate, paperwork, she's gone, right? And that's the debate. They're trying to dig Jesus into that debate several times. But Jesus turned the tables on both of them. And essentially what Jesus says, any marriage that, where there's a divorce and there hasn't already been adultery, the divorce creates adultery. In other words, when he says except for sexual immorality, he's saying unless there already was adultery, this is adultery. If you turn into Matthew 19, verses 3 through 9, Jesus explains it a little further. And I don't think it's a coincidence that of all the commandments we look to, Jesus has the most to say about this one. Matthew 19, the Pharisees come up to him and they test him by asking, is it lawful to divorce one's wife for any cause? Trying to drag him into the debate. And he answered, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female and said, therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. And they said to him, well, why then did Moses command one to give a certificate of divorce and to send her away? He said to them, because of your hardness of heart, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives. But from the beginning, it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. The Pharisees want Jesus to take sides on the when is divorce okay debate. And Jesus goes back to Genesis. That's old radio show for some of you. Jesus says, here's the deal. God created them, male and female, in the image of God. And God designed marriage to be so intimate that when God joins male and female, God says they are one flesh. And man has no business separating what God has brought together. That's Jesus' answer. The Pharisees go back to Deuteronomy 24 again. They say, well, why did Moses command that he give a certificate of divorce? Nowhere in Deuteronomy does Moses command anyone give anyone a certificate of divorce. So Jesus says Moses allowed you to give a certificate of divorce because of the hardness of your heart. Folks, it is never praiseworthy to do something because of the hardness of your heart. He said, Moses let you do this because you're sinful at heart, and if you didn't do this, it would be horrible for the one divorced. If you didn't give her that certificate of divorce, then what? You just kicked her to the curb and she's your spouse and she's doomed. She would die. But then he says, God never designed it that way. It was not that way. By God's design. And again, he comes down to any divorce where adultery is not already occurred is itself adultery, and remarriage just adds to that. Now, I know many preachers that I respect and that you respect are going to say that Jesus gives an out here, that he gives an exception, that he says divorce is okay for adultery. Is Jesus offering an out here? I don't see it. As I read this, Jesus is saying, if there's already been adultery, you can't make her commit adultery because she already did it. But I would just ask you to do this. If you've got other preachers you respect who say there's an exception here, read the text and ask yourself, what does Jesus say? I think you can do that. If your Christian spirit of God dwells within you, read the text and ask what Jesus says. Okay? What does Jesus do with the seventh commandment? He does this, and this is the big one. He reveals that it's a heart issue. Lust is adultery. He reveals that it is severe. It deserves hell. And then he eliminates divorce as a way to get around adultery. Because that's what most people were making of this. If I just divorce her, if I just do the paperwork, I can go get me another woman. Then it's not adultery because I did the paperwork. That's why I said Jesus' words are hard. Because I'm pretty sure that if we read what Jesus said honestly, we've all just been revealed to be adulterers. Lust in the heart, wandering eyes and sinful thoughts. How many can really say not guilty? Divorce and remarriage, using the law of land to get around the design of God. If we're not guilty, we love many who are. Jesus' interpretation of the seventh commandment is hard, but we haven't heard everything Jesus said about it. I praise God that we also get to turn to John chapter 8. Turn to John 8. John chapter 8, starting in verse 3. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and placing her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such a woman. What do you say?" This they said to test him, that they might have some charge to bring against him. Jesus bent down and he wrote with his finger on the ground, and as they continued to ask him, he stood up and said to them, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And once more he bent down and wrote in the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing there before him. And Jesus stood up and said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She says, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go, and from now on, sin no more." This woman is caught in the act. She is an adulteress. We can only speculate as to what happened to the man, and it does us no good to do that. But she's been caught in the act. She is guilty, and the Pharisees asked Jesus to comment on the death penalty for her. Right? And they're trying to trick him, right? If he says yes, put her to death, he's in trouble with Rome, because Rome doesn't let the Jews do the Old Testament death penalty. If he says no, don't put her to death, he's in trouble with the Jews, because the commandment, the law of Moses says, stone her to death. So she's guilty, and Jesus is in a pickle if he weren't Jesus. They give him a choice, A or B, and Jesus says none of the above. But I think, let's not lose sight of this. She is guilty. She deserves death according to the Old Testament law. She deserves hell according to what Jesus said earlier. And Jesus can't just turn a blind eye to sin. He's holy. What's he do here? Jesus forgives her. Jesus forgives her. Because that's what Jesus does. Jesus forgives sinners. Jesus forgives adulterers and adulteresses. And he doesn't do it. He doesn't turn a blind eye to her sin, right? Nowhere does he say, "I know you didn't do it." Or he says, doesn't say, "Hey, no biggie." Never does he say that. He forgives her. He says, "They don't condemn you, and I don't condemn you." How does he do that? He does that because he is the one who will take her adultery upon himself. He will own the guilt and the shame of her adultery as he goes to the cross and dies for her sin. He will pay the death penalty. He will pay the hell penalty for her sin. Pay it in full. And he forgives her. And if you are guilty by your eyes and your heart, or by treating divorce as a way to get around adultery, if you are guilty this morning and you trust Jesus, Jesus forgives you. Praise God. John 8 is there, right? Because I don't know about you, but I read Matthew 5 and Matthew 19. The weight is more than I can bear. Praise God, we have John 8 where Jesus carried the weight. He doesn't just refine the commandment. Jesus deals with our sin. Isn't that good news? So Israel, the command is protect marriage. It's tied to the covenant. Jesus comes and he refines the commandment. He makes the weight of it more than we can bear in our sin. But then he deals with it in grace and mercy. And then we get to the New Testament. What we see is Paul shows us how the command to protect marriage is also tied to God's covenant relationship with his church. The command against adultery is repeated in the New Testament. Adultery is still sin. Nothing in the finished work of Christ has changed God's desire for his people to remain faithful in their covenant marriage. In Ephesians 5, chapter 22 and following, Paul talks about, and I read part of that this morning as we opened our worship, Paul is specific about how life in the marriage covenant is directly related to the covenant God has with his church. He even talks about his church as the bride of Christ. Right? He's saying that your marriages and the way husbands treat wives and wives treat husbands need to reflect my relationship with my bride. They need to reflect that. In fact, he goes through and he's saying, wives do this, husbands do this. And in the end, he says, but I'm really talking about Christ and the church. Now, there's so much we could do in looking at Ephesians 5, but the key for us this morning is in Ephesians 5, verse 32, where Paul says it refers to Christ and the church. The reasons why wives need to honor husbands and husbands need to sacrificially love their wives is that their marriage needs to reflect what Jesus did for his bride and how his bride treats her king. Needs to reflect the covenant between Christ and the church. Your marriage, Christian, needs to reflect what you believe about the gospel. As you shall not commit adultery is written on your minds and your hearts. If you're a Christian, it is, right? The new covenant, the law is written on their minds and on their hearts. So the command, you shall not commit adultery, it's written on your mind. And it's written on your heart. As it does that, it sits closely beside the command, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. The command to keep this covenant, the command to keep this covenant, God takes them and he binds them. He binds them. Your desire to reflect who you are in Christ needs to stand side by side for your desire to be the husband or be the wife that God has called you to be in covenant relationship. They go together. Don't commit spiritual adultery as the bride of Christ. Don't commit adultery as the bride or the husband of your spouse. The command to protect marriage is tied, as it was to the old covenant, to the new covenant. Adultery remains the great sin. It is the great sin when it destroys the relationship God designed between husbands and wives. And it is the great sin because it reflects rebellion against covenants like the one you have with the God who saved you. Jesus will have nothing to do with the modern idea that you can get around your marriage covenant if you fill out the right paperwork with the government. It was not so from the beginning, Jesus said. But Jesus also would say this, praise God, he says this too. If you will confess your sin, he is faithful and just to forgive you of your sin and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And then, like he said to the woman caught in adultery, after he said, I don't condemn you, he said, go and sin no more. Sin no more. The gospel remains the gospel. Christ forgives sinners, but he does call for them to actually follow him once they're forgiven. And if we do that, we must see the necessity of protecting marriage. The seventh commandment was and is all about protecting marriage. Marriage has always reflected the covenant between God and his people. Jesus revealed that adultery is a heart thing. He revealed that it's associated with divorce, but then he did something wonderful. He reminded us all that he is a Savior who forgives sinners. What glorious news. Because this commandment and his words leave many of us dealing with sin, I want to close this morning with one more passage from Scripture. You may want to turn with me to Psalm 51. Psalm 51 applies this morning for a really good reason. You see, at the beginning of Psalm 51, it says, this is a psalm of David when Nathan the prophet went to him after he had gone in to Bathsheba. Psalm 51 is David's response when Nathan the prophet said, David, you are an adulterer. When David saw the adultery that he had committed, his sin of adultery, these were his words. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. By God's grace and the person and work of Jesus Christ, every adulterer and adulteress can pray those words, the same words David prayed in his adultery. Every adulterer, every adulteress, trusting in the work of Jesus, can pray those words and get up and say, I am forgiven. I am clean. So let me just offer you something to do with this. First of all, if you're married, work at it. Work at it. The two are made one flesh, but the reality is the world would love nothing to do than tear that flesh apart And you're going to feel that pull every time. You're going to hear the temptations, see the temptations, feel the temptations. Fight for your marriage. And if you have failed in the fight for your marriage, turn to Jesus. Jesus forgives sins. Be forgiven and go and sin no more. And take this message to those you know who need to hear it. There are a lot of messed up, things going on in our world. And one of the most messed up is the way the world talks about marriage and the relationship between men and women today. And we've gone so far down the road, it doesn't even look like a road anymore. So let's be faithful to the message of God's word about His design for marriage. And let's teach that, but let's also be faithful to this. Let's always offer the gospel. Let's always offer Jesus. Because as we offer God's design for marriage, 9 times out of 10, that's going to hit hard. So as we offer that, let's always offer Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your word this morning. God, we thank You for the gift of marriage. Because it is a beautiful and wonderful gift. And God, I pray for the marriages in our church family. I pray that You would strengthen them. That You would give husbands and wives a deep love and respect for one another. A deep commitment to one another. That You would protect their marriages. I pray for those who have suffered the painful reality of divorce. God, I pray that You would heal broken hearts. I pray that You would forgive sins and help them to know in their hearts the joy of being forgiven of sins. And I pray that You would help us as the body of Christ to be faithful to proclaim this message to a lost and dying world. And God, I do pray that if one sitting here this morning has heard this message, and as they heard about their adulterous sin, heard about their sin for the very first time, I pray that this morning they would turn to Christ, be forgiven, and be saved. And Lord, I just pray that You would help us all live lives that would glorify You. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Brother Tom's going to come lead us in our closing hymn, and as he does, I would ask you to consider how you need to deal with the Word of God today. First of all, you need to believe it. You need to trust it. And then second of all, you need to ask is where it hits you in your life. And deal with that. Deal with that this morning. And maybe you need to deal with that publicly. Maybe you need to come forward and say, look, I recognize this in my life and I need the body of Christ to come alongside me because I need help. Maybe you're hurting because of the effects of adultery. Maybe you just need prayer to stay faithful. Whatever it is, deal with the Word of God today. Please stand.